Growing up, in our early years, we encountered two remarkably similar authority figures. Both figures were presented as loving, but it was an odd kind of love. Jealous, inconsistent, possessive, vengeful, divisive. They would set traps to test the folks they supposedly loved, presenting their targets with impossible, damned if you do, damned if you don't choices. This love would evaporate instantly in response to any exercise of independence. Both figures were presented as blameless. They were perfectly moral, righteous, and beyond criticism. If their actions caused destruction, harm, even death, blame was deflected onto others. If their behavior seemed contradictory, hypocritical, or just plain cruel, it was because we were too young and inexperienced to understand their superior morality. Both figures were presented as omniscient. We were repeatedly told they both knew our minds better than we did, which was deeply confusing because they so often got it wrong. We'd be accused of transgressions we'd never committed, thoughts we'd never entertained, personality traits we didn't recognize. Who were these two figures? One was a parent. The other was a god, and both of them narcissists. It's a disorder that shows up in situations from abusive one-to-one relationships to reality-twisting political, religious, and social groups. Too often, it goes undetected. Sometimes it's downplayed as harmless personality quirks. Sometimes the narcissist holds a protected authority position, allowing them to get away with abuses we wouldn't normally tolerate. Sometimes we're dealing with what's called a communal narcissist, who puts on a deeply humanitarian act for the community and abuses behind closed doors. Narcissism is a big factor in religious and domestic abuse, and awareness of its distinctive symptoms is growing. The term narcissist originates in the story of Narcissus, featured in Ovid's Metamorphoses, who was widely desired for his beauty. A young nymph called Echo fell in love with him, but he rejected her, and she faded away until all that remained of her was her voice, which could only repeat what other people said. Nemesis, the god of justice and revenge, cursed Narcissus to pursue unattainable love. He fell in love with his own reflection in a pool, and, fixated on the image, slowly wasted away, replaced by a flower. Therapist Joan Lashkar describes narcissists as individuals who need perfect mirroring, perfect stroking, perfect responses, who have idealized and omnipotent fantasies and seek out others to confirm or justify exaggerated entitlement fantasies and distortions that the world is deeply indebted to them. Although Narcissus was captivated by his physical reflection, narcissists generally avoid personal self-reflection. Critical examination conflicts with their grandiose self-image, and taking responsibility for their mistakes and transgressions is unbearable to them, leading to bizarre deflections of blame onto others. Because of their superiority complex, they're easily insulted by perceived criticisms and enraged when they don't get the excessive respect or adoration they crave. They're controlling and resentfully jealous when others get the attention they seek for themselves. They expect others to cater exclusively to them and disregard other people's needs. The needs of the narcissist eclipse everything and everyone else. Other people are just pawns in the narcissist's grand plan. The combination of an unstable sense of self, a lack of empathy, and a fiery determination to get what they want results in unpredictable, capricious behavior. Malignant narcissists will inflict gratuitous suffering on others for their own gratification. We want to explore this pathology. Are gods inevitably narcissistic? How do targets get manipulated? How far does the narcissist's poison spread? And how do we go about extracting ourselves? Even if the Jewish Tanakh, the Christian Bible, and the Islamic Quran weren't dripping with illustrations of all the narcissistic traits, narcissism is written into the blueprint of all these God concepts because of two factors. First, their monotheistic nature. Second, their human inventor's overzealous desire for justice. Writing in the 1800s, philosopher Ludwig Feuerbach points out that monotheism creates a special problem. Whereas polytheism gives room for good and evil gods, monotheism is forced to combine good and evil into one being, creating a god with conflicting attributes. Feuerbach notes that humans who believe all things were created for their sole benefit and that there should be no evils run into a universe that conflicts with these self-centered beliefs by imposing all kinds of suffering. This is the classic problem of evil. Writing in the 1700s, philosopher David Hume summarized the problem. Is the monotheist God willing to prevent evil but not able? Then he is impotent. Is he able but not willing? Then he is malevolent. Is he both able and willing? Then where does evil come from? All these statements assume the God in question is aware of our suffering. An unaware God could be considered blameless. But folks who propose an interventionist God, intimately aware of human suffering, can't claim divine ignorance. So, we're back to impotence, malevolence, or callousness. Feuerbach notes that, to try and preserve their deity's good and helpful image, some theists treat human suffering as punishments for transgressions. Destructive aspects of the natural universe are reframed as expressions of divine, righteous anger. Justice is misattributed to a universe that has no inherent justice. This profound distortion of reality creates a core characteristic of narcissism, capriciousness. In his paper, Divine Narcissism and Yahweh's Parenting Style, Stuart Lazine notes that abusers use capriciousness as a tool to impose domination. By following no discernible rules, human narcissists put their targets in a perpetually confused state, wondering what's coming next. Likewise, a divine narcissist that causes random suffering puts humans in a perpetually confused state. It also leads directly to persecution games, when humans argue about why good people suffer. One persecution game is called Suffering for the Few. Here, the universe punishes good people for failing to condemn bad people. For example, natural disasters have been blamed on the acceptance of gay people. This game dehumanizes specific groups, turning them into scapegoats. In another persecution game called Born Wrong, the universe punishes good people because they're not actually good at all. It's claimed that we're all born defective and have to try to overcome our rotten nature. Here, everyone is dehumanized and open to abuse, sometimes self-inflicted. Ironically, monotheism's failure to explain why countless good people suffer has resulted in countless more good people suffering. Far from solving the problem of evil, these persecution games just add more evil to be accounted for, taking us back to a deity who is either unable or unwilling to prevent it. To get round the problem of evil, some monotheists have even tried to smuggle in polytheistic concepts. In Christianity, Satan is introduced as a shadow god, taking on the destructive aspect of the universe, to establish the main god Yahweh as the good cop. Jehovah's Witnesses even view Satan as the ruler of the world. But this only shifts the problem of evil back a step, giving us a deity who's aware of Satan's evil, but either unable or unwilling to prevent it. When humans project their wishful desire for justice onto an unjust universe by inventing a single, omniscient, all-powerful, interventionist God, the paths repeatedly lead back to narcissist territory and division and suffering. Leo Tolstoy's novel Anna Karenina begins with the line, "Happy families are all alike, Every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. But the unhappiness that surrounds narcissists follows a very distinctive pattern. In comparing their experiences of narcissists, many folks have commented that it's almost as if their abusers all read the same instruction manual. That's because we're dealing with a similar mindset. The mindset of a maniacal child, determined to get what it wants, with all the crude strategies of an infant. Like infants, human and divine narcissists exhibit stark, black-and-white thinking. People are idealized or demonized. In families, offspring are typically split into the favored golden child and the despised scapegoat who gets all the blame, sparking deep divisions. In the Bible, divine narcissist Yahweh has many golden children and scapegoats. He gives Gideon extraordinary preferential treatment, choosing him to lead the Israelite army and defeat the Midianites, even though Gideon repeatedly breaks a divine rule by testing Yahweh to provide miraculous proofs. Gideon's father is a worshipper of Baal, a sin against the jealous Yahweh, and we're told children will be punished for their parents' blasphemous worship. But Gideon not only escapes all punishment, is chosen as Yahweh's champion. Golden children aren't immune to abuse. Job is initially blessed for being Yahweh's faithful servant. But then, Yahweh agrees to let Satan attack Job relentlessly, destroying all he values, killing his 10 children, just to see if this will provoke Job into cursing Yahweh. At the end of the story, we're told that Yahweh restores Job's fortunes, giving him 10 more children to replace the murdered ones. This is a chilling, psychopathic view of restoration. Humans aren't replaceable objects, but that's how we're seen by malignant, black-and-white thinking narcissists who can quickly turn golden children into scapegoats and vice versa. Black-and-white thinking underpins the binary system of hell and heaven. Imagine a human legal system where everything from genocide to stealing an apple was punished with a life sentence. Who could fail to see the absurdity of such a system? But millions of people defend an even more absurd system that not only extends the sentence from life to eternity, but adds thought crime, giving the thought the same weight as the act. Some apologists for Yahweh have claimed that because he's conceived as an infinite being, transgressions against him become infinite transgressions, deserving infinite punishment. This reasoning goes in exactly the wrong direction. Stealing an apple from a man who only has one apple to his name has a much greater impact than stealing an apple from a man who owns 50 orchards. If we're going to take the scale of the injured party into account in sentencing, we're looking at an inverse relationship. The larger the party, the smaller the impact, the shorter the sentencing. As the injured party approaches infinity, the sentence doesn't approach infinity, it approaches zero. The maniacal child is concerned only with getting what it wants. Playing fair makes no sense. The narcissist plays dirty, instigating psychological games by adopting the dramatic roles of persecutor or victim to tenderize their targets into submission. Both roles are abusive and employ emotional blackmail to arouse fear, obligation, guilt, and sympathy. These strategies are clearly implemented in the Christian Bible. In the Old Testament, Yahweh is in full persecutor mode, condemning all of humanity for the theft of a piece of fruit, committing genocide after genocide, and repeatedly declaring his desire to be feared. In the New Testament, Yahweh flips into victim mode, staging a contrived piece of theater in which he sacrifices himself to himself. But what was the real reason for this so-called sacrifice? Yahweh had invented a system of magic that demanded blood to atone for sins. To honor this blood magic, Yahweh commanded humans to perform animal sacrifices. Then he decided to stop this practice. But according to the rules he invented, blood still had to be shed. Yahweh could have simply chosen to change those rules. He changed all kinds of other rules to suit himself. But he freely chooses an act of self-immolation, and he does it in the most manipulative, melodramatic way, getting humans to kill him. If he insisted on shedding his own blood, he could have done it privately, without any fanfare. Or, instead of being sacrificed in human form, he could have been born as a sacrificial goat or pig, a fitting final sacrifice, in view of all the animals needlessly slaughtered in his name. But then there would have been no drama, and drama is oxygen to the narcissist. This was no genuine sacrifice. just selfish theatrics designed to dump false guilt onto humans to deflect attention from Yahweh's mistakes. Sadly, victims of narcissists often end up feeling like they're the guilty ones. In the story of Job, who ended up apologizing? Was it Yahweh, who colluded in Job's torment just to satisfy his own vanity? Or was it Job, who suffered the torment? Narcissists rarely apologize. If pushed, they might give evasive non-apologies, or faux-pologies, using distancing or conditional language, or claiming both parties are equally to blame. Different situations call for different personal boundaries. After damage to a relationship, it's normal to have a period of distance to reflect on what's happened. But when narcissists perform an apology, instant forgiveness is expected. And if it's not given, the abuse can soon start again, showing how meaningless the apology was. Boundaries are so alien to narcissistic gods, they grant divine forgiveness on behalf of everyone else. When we attended church as children, we noticed how priests routinely passed on divine forgiveness to individuals who never sought it from the ones they abused. No one can absolve us for our trespasses against other people. Forgiveness comes, or doesn't come, from the injured party. Boundaries make it clear what we will and won't accept, and they're crucial in any relationship. Narcissists hate boundaries. Targets are seen as possessions with no identity of their own. Narcissistic lovers expect partners to adopt their preferences. Narcissistic parents feel entitled to choose their offspring's partners and careers. Narcissistic gods even violate the privacy of our minds, monitoring and punishing our thoughts. When targets start establishing basic boundaries, the narcissist reacts with rage and punishment. When non-believers establish the reasonable boundary of independent thought, they're ostracized, condemned, and threatened with eternal torture. But it's when a target establishes a terminal boundary and walks out for good that the drama can escalate, sometimes becoming deadly. For narcissists, total rejection is the worst crime of all. We see it with human narcissists, who relentlessly persecute former lovers, and we see it with divine narcissists. Special animosity is reserved for apostates, like ex-Muslims and ex-Catholics, who are labeled culpably ignorant. Non-believers who've never heard the message are considered blameless and potentially savable. But ex-Muslims and ex-Catholics are said to have heard the true message of their religions and stubbornly rejected it, putting them beyond salvation. Ex-Muslims continue to be ostracized, harassed, imprisoned, and murdered for rejecting the narcissist god of Islam. There are narcissists in all walks of life, but they can be hardest to deal with when they hold protected social positions. Magical thinking doesn't just apply to supernatural beings. The subject of families provokes all kinds of magical ideas about obligation, intrinsic value, and irreplaceability, which serve to protect narcissists in the family, who play on the deep social taboos associated with family conflict to keep abuse under the radar. Abusive families can act like cults, closed systems with no external appeal. It's been said that blood is thicker than water, and for very family-orientated people who've enjoyed genuinely healthy, supportive relationships, it can be deeply unsettling to hear values like that being questioned. But for many families where there's narcissistic abuse, blood is just messier than water. Magical thinking extends to other figures who are unthinkingly treated as surrogate parents. Therapists, rabbis, priests, imams, presidents and prime ministers, royalty. We assume they're looking after our interests. When it turns out they're just looking after their own interests, at our expense, our magical thinking can put us in a state of denial. Gods are the ultimate parent figures, and theistic religions attract many human narcissists who feel no shame in claiming to speak on their god's behalf. The powerful magical thinking that surrounds gods shields these religious narcissists who use their protected positions to become the focus of worship themselves. On the subject of worship, the ancient Greek philosopher Xenophanes famously criticized the human tendency to attribute gods with human traits and desires, especially human flaws. The need to be worshipped is one such human flaw, and it's a self-defeating flaw. The very act of demanding worship exposes a deep inadequacy, confirming the individual's unworthiness. it's important to recognize worship for what it is, a response to threat. In the face of danger, we instinctively react in one of several ways. We fight, we take flight, we freeze. Another strategy is to fawn, to submit, to please, to praise, to worship. Some claim that worship is a free expression of adoration, but you only have to look at the threats and attacks aimed at those of us who decline to worship any gods to recognize the underlying coercion. If it was a free expression, we would be unmolested. Things go from bad to bizarre when we come to the narcissist tactic of gaslighting. The concept of gaslighting originates from a 1938 play by Patrick Hamilton, adapted into the brilliant 1940 film Gaslight, in which a husband tries to convince his wife she's going mad. What she doesn't know is that her husband is a murderer, who each night secretly searches for jewels he thinks are hidden above the apartment. Whenever he lights the gaslight above the apartment to search for the jewels, the gaslight dims in the rooms below. When his wife comments on the dimming gaslight, he tells her she's imagining it. Like the tyrannical husband in Gaslight, narcissists will often try to gaslight their targets, to use lies, denial, and psychological tricks to make their targets distrust their own memory, perceptions, and behavior, even their own sanity. The Abrahamic religions have gaslighting down to a fine art, proposing incoherent values and rules that are impossible to observe consistently, putting followers in impossible double binds by condoning and condemning the same behaviors, declaring acts that cause no conceivable injury to be worthy of torture and death, pronouncing us guilty of events before our birth. These maneuvers erode our sense of judgment, making us more susceptible to religious control. We're directed to develop a relationship with a divine being who we're told withholds evidence of itself for the bizarre reason that it wants us to have the option of not believing it exists. If human parents deliberately withheld all evidence of their existence from a child while claiming to want a relationship with the child, we'd immediately see the madness of that scenario. Substitute human parent with divine being, and we get exactly the same madness. Our well-founded questions and criticisms are met with constantly shifting goalposts and the pretense that contradiction is actually profound mystery. We're explicitly instructed to distrust our own judgment. This is all done to get targets to accept the false reality of the narcissist. Establishing a false reality isn't a trivial issue for the narcissist. It's a matter of survival. It means they don't have to face the truth about themselves. In Lyman Frank Baum's story of The Wizard of Oz, winged monkeys were sent to do the bidding of the Wicked Witch of the West. The term flying monkeys is now commonly used to refer to individuals who act as the agents of narcissists. Sometimes these agents conspire knowingly and maliciously, but they've often been manipulated unknowingly into believing the propaganda of the narcissist. These are the people who the narcissist uses to spread lies, gather information, and conduct smear campaigns about the targets. If a scapegoat cuts off all contact with their abuser, flying monkeys will be sent to employ emotional blackmail on behalf of the narcissist to lure the scapegoat back. Scapegoats might be despised by the narcissist, but they provide a hefty supply of drama, which the narcissist craves. Narcissists can choose flying monkeys from their own social circle, or even the social circle of the scapegoat, if the narcissist can manipulate them into switching loyalties. But they're often walking in a minefield, and can become scapegoats themselves if they spoil the narcissist's plans. When it comes to religion, flying monkeys can make up whole communities, acting as the agents of a being whose very existence isn't established. Many self-appointed religious flying monkeys target non-believers as scapegoats, conducting smear campaigns, maligning their character and their morality, ostracizing them, and applying emotional blackmail to pressure them into accepting their narcissist god. While the role of flying monkey is focused on manipulating the targets of the narcissist, the role of enabler is focused on protecting and rescuing the narcissist. Enablers provide excuses, or cover for the narcissist's abusive behavior. There's no conflict between acting as an enabler and a flying monkey, and many people play both roles. Enablers minimize or deny the narcissist's aggression. They help to conceal abuse from outside scrutiny, echo the views of the narcissist, and support the narcissist's false reality, trying to reframe the narcissist's conduct as normal. Enabling is formalized in religious apologetics, the practice of defending scriptural accounts and doctrines from criticism, like the aforementioned story of Job. Any human parents agreeing to let others torture their children just to test their loyalty would rightly be seen as twisted monsters. But when Yahweh does this to Job, it's defended as perfect morality by religious enablers. When it came to dealing with our narcissistic parent, we both realized at a very young age that something was seriously wrong, although we didn't have a word for it for many years. We instinctively began to minimize contact with her and limit personal information. We shared no confidences and asked no advice. We didn't know it, but our instinctive detachment was a recommended strategy for dealing with narcissists. It's called grey rock, because that's what you imitate. A grey rock is unremarkable, unprovocative. The message you send to the narcissist is that there's nothing of interest for them here, no source of drama. When we revealed our atheism to the family in our early teenage years, one of us had a sense of the all-out war we were about to experience. The other one was blissfully unsuspecting. But neither of us ever regretted the move. Sometimes in life, you have to choose between two poisons. The poison of being abused for claiming your rights, and the poison of surrendering your rights to avoid abuse. It's always down to the individual to judge which poison represents the greater risk. When we moved out, the drama continued, and gradually we reduced contact. After many years, the manipulative behavior seemed to ease off. For a time, we thought there'd been a genuine change. We were wrong. When narcissists sense they're losing their targets, they can behave themselves for a time, but the underlying pathology remains and often deepens. In time, the mind games return. They did, in our case, with a destructive vengeance. We realized it was the end of the line. Each of us has to decide what we're willing to put up with and what we're not. And some of us eventually decide to go no contact. In extreme cases, restraining orders are sometimes needed to enforce the message. There's a big difference between healthy and naive compassion. Healthy compassion considers the needs of everyone involved in a situation and makes clear-headed judgments on what's helpful and harmful. With naive compassion, sympathy is misguidedly offered to individuals who exploit sympathy for selfish motives. Because of this, naive compassion can end up enabling and increasing suffering. We can have compassion for destructive people, but we don't have to allow their destructiveness into our lives. Dealing with divine narcissists is simultaneously simpler and more complicated. Despite all the threats, no narcissist god comes after us seeking revenge. In religion, we never experience the central narcissist. No divine manipulations or punishments. No direct divine abuse, just scriptural stories about it. The abuse is generated and perpetrated exclusively by human religious flying monkeys to serve their imagined masters. The issue of choosing poisons becomes deadly serious in religions like Islam, where flying monkeys dispense death penalties for rejecting the narcissist. Here, the rest of us can help by supporting those targets. Being the target of a narcissist can be confusing, unpleasant, sometimes dangerous, but it can also shake you awake. Experiencing the false reality of human and divine narcissists can motivate you to think about how to effectively sift truth from lies. It can inspire you to question the illusions you hold and replace them with ever more rigorous models of reality. Despair is defined as the complete loss or absence of hope. It's a word associated with anguish and dejection. But the loss of hope can be liberating and signal a return to health. When we stop hoping for the impossible, hoping for a just universe, hoping for a death-denying afterlife, hoping for a destructive, parasitic individual to change into a decent human being, we can begin to reconnect with reality and stop worshipping narcissists. Thank you.